So this video is more about the reports on that particular apartment complex in Hong Kong in the Amoy Gardens. And there was an architectural study made of the airflows at this particular apartment complex, apparently published fairly quickly, May 2nd, 2003. The first page, the executive summary, we'll take a quick look at. So the scope of our work is to study, by means of computational fluid dynamics, the potential for air, water vapor, and airborne particulate matter, presumably under 10 micrometers, to circulate from one flat to another. This PM under 10 would appear to be referring to aerosols and particles that are typically not called droplets. We limit our scope to the study of the airflow around and through the building blocks, especially within the narrow re-entrant spaces, also called or also known as light wells. And I will tend to use the word light wells as opposed to re-entrant spaces. The light wells are an indentation in a building plan between the adjacent flats and is an important feature for most Hong Kong housing blocks. Most kitchen and bathroom windows and exhaust vents are located in that space. Previous studies have revealed the potential for exhaust air from one flat to enter neighboring flats through this light well. We are not aware of any evidence that SARS virus is airborne. So here's the disclaimer. We're not aware of any evidence that SARS virus is airborne, and we do not attempt to address this issue. However, if others determine that the virus may be carried by air or water vapor, then studies such as this may be useful to investigate the correlation between airflow and disease spread. So, a little disclaimer. Thus, our study is motivated by three principal questions. What characteristics of this particular apartment building might contribute to the spread in an airborne pathogen? How prevalent are these characteristics to other buildings in Hong Kong? What design modifications or retrofit would reduce the exchange of air and water vapor between these flats? Soon after the SARS outbreak was recognized, questions were raised as to whether the virus might be airborne or transmitted through air movement. To determine this hypothesis, we have developed a series of models and run a set of simulations. The hypothesis that water vapor and the spread of SARS at this particular apartment complex. So, apparently there's a lot of conflict on what the information needs to come out from these reports, and you can tell from the way this is written. But getting to what the actual wording is the bathroom floor drains with dried up U-traps provided a pathway through which the residents came into contact with the small droplets containing viruses from contaminated sewage. These droplets entered the bathroom floor drain through negative pressure generated by exhaust fans. Picture what we're talking about. We have three P-traps coming out of each bathroom. We have the light well here running up and down this building. And we have all these bathrooms that are in block 8 and block 7 adjoining or adjacent to this light well. So there are three P-traps, one for the sink, one for the toilet, and one for the floor. And usually two of these three would be routinely used and routinely filled with water so that there is no backflow coming back from the air that is in these pipes. But the one that is on the floor probably is the least likely to have water in it, unless there was a recent flooding of the bathroom. The bathroom floor drains had a dried up P-trap, which provided a pathway for air through which residents came in contact with small droplets containing viruses from the contaminated sewage. These droplets entered the bathroom floor drain through negative pressure. Okay, so they're saying it would normally have lied dormant into the P-trap even though it was dried, but only got pulled up into the room because of the negative pressure generated by the exhaust fan. If the low pressure difference induced by a typical bathroom exhaust fan is sufficient to pull contaminated droplets up from the sewage drain around a dry P-trap and into the inhabited space, then it seems likely that such droplets may be transported by other means as well. It is worth exploring other possible routes and convenience. It is worth exploring. So here it seems like the exploration has been squashed. If the exhaust fans pulled contaminated droplets from the floor drains and into the inhabited space, then they almost certainly would also exhaust many of these droplets out into the light wells, and that is what the design of the fans was intended to do. Moreover, if they could lift the droplets from the floor drain, then they could certainly expel them from the infected. Okay, so there's a lot of whizzly words happening here. The government report also documented a chimney effect within the light well. And there would be a chimney effect in that light well. And theorized that it might even have been sufficient to carry contaminated droplets up from a crack pipe on the fourth floor, although most of the infection occurred at floors 10 and above. So the hard part is, for everybody to explain, is why this is moving upwards as much as it is, and why these droplets aren't falling down by the action of gravity as you'd normally expect. So it seems probable that contaminated droplets entered the light well. If airflow carried these droplets into other apartments, this could be a significant path for disease spread, completely independent of the sewage system. We have focused on the flow of air and water vapor within the spaces, especially the spaces between units 7 and 8 of Block E, and the units that suffered the highest attack rates, meaning the highest disease folks and some fatalities. So here are the findings of the report, several findings, and they're all shown graphically. Figures 2 through 4, 5 through 7, 8 through 13, 14, 15, 16, up to 17. So we'll go through those. So this is the modeling of the complex, if you will. And E and F are the ones of most interest. And they were completely modeled with the light wells, whereas the other buildings were simplified and didn't have the light wells included. This is the airflow with arrows showing the speed in meters per second of the airflow going through the buildings. It goes from 0 to 5 meters per second. So the red arrows are the faster airflows around the buildings. In front of the particular light well we're interested in, there is a significant airflow, high-speed airflow, causing a static zone, if you will, within this air well. And if you look at the pressures generated, the airflow hitting these buildings straight on are causing a slight positive pressure of 14 pascals, 14 being red on the scale, 0 being green, and minus 14 being the blue. So there's sort of a very slight vacuum on the backsides of these buildings where the wind flows are. But the area we're interested in is this light well here, which appears to be perfectly green and perfectly at zero pressure. So if we look at the airflow up and down into the air well as this building is cut in this direction, it shows some of the flows that may occur from one flat to another, one apartment to another apartment. And here the airspeed goes from 0 to 2 meters per second. Not a lot of red on here, but probably the highest is this yellow area where the ceiling might be swept out. And some of this flow would go potentially to the adjacent apartment or up the light well. The dark blue to the green are about 0.9 to 0.1 meters per second. A cut away from the middle of the building, we can see the airflow going through the two apartments. So on this side, there would be slight positive pressure because it's upwind. And if this window is open, some of the flow would come into this apartment. And this apartment would be roughly at zero pressure. The light well seems to be a little bit on the bluer side, so ever so slight vacuum throughout the second apartment, and then higher negative pressure or vacuum on the backside here. So that this would tend to generate a flow, an airflow direction going in this direction between the flats, between the apartments. Airflow flew through the block, and you can see the vectors and the speeds going from fairly still. The dark blue is on the near zero side, and then the red is up to 5 meters per second. So you can see the high flows in front of the light well. And you can also see some flows going through the two apartments and how the flow will actually go through both of them and come back the backside, where there seems to be sort of a eddy, vacuum eddy on the backside. Airflow through coming out the vents, the fan, the bathroom fan, shows that a lot of it in the high velocity air will actually wind up directly across to the other apartment, and some of the air would get into the apartment just above it, and some of this air will drift up to the top light well space. Here it's looking at water vapor being exhausted from the bathroom and where it would generally go in terms of whether to go up the light well or into the neighboring apartment. And here the speeds go from 0 meters per second up to 3 on the red, so the high velocity air would go directly across, and the majority of it would go directly across. Here it's looking at water vapor exhausting from one apartment to the other. And most of that water vapor would again wind up into the other apartment as opposed to going up the light well. So the ceiling of the other bathroom probably would be where most of that water vapor would go. Interestingly enough, this air is the highest velocity air, and it's producing eddies in the light well. So it's not the light well that's governing the direction of flow, it's the exhaust fans in this still air, because this air curtain is caused by this really fast air, moving air coming across here. from the top side how the water vapor exhausts away from one apartment into the other apartment's living room, living space. Here is the water vapor of the same broken sewer pipe. You still see how it moves through the apartment. And here are remedies and the results from those remedies. One of them is increasing this space so that the light well has got a larger space and tried to make this air not so static. And then pressure-wise, you can see that the larger area maybe makes this space a little more green as opposed to the teal color, more of a neutral pressure of zero. And then here's sort of a baffle being put in to help airflow into this area. And you see a positive pressure building on this end of the baffle and sort of a negative pressure zone on the back side of the baffle. The vectors for that same scenario, maybe the same length panel, where you have a little bit more circulation of air coming in and coming back out. So there's more active flow. The vectors are not so still. They're not the dark blue. They're more into the green and yellow range. That was a pretty good analysis.